Anybody glad to be here on today to say, Lord, I lift your name on high? When you're first, we're going to sing together. Lord, I lift your name on high. It's a really easy song. So if you say, God, I lift your name on high, no matter what I'm going through, I'm oppressing your presence. If you say, Lord, I lift your name on high, come on, let's just sing this together. It's a really easy song. I'm going to sing it, and I want you to join in with me. Amen. Come on and put your hands together.
Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us.
Come on, let's sing that together.
Lord, I lift your name on high.
I lift your name on high, oh God, above all
Lord,
names.
I love to sing your praises.
God, I love to sing your praises.
I'm so glad you're in my life.
Anybody glad that God is in their lives? What would you do without him? Where would you be
I'm
without
so glad him? You
Come on, let's just sing that together one more time. Lord, I lift your name on high.
Lord, I lift your name on high.
God, I'm going to lift your name on high.
Lord, I love to
God,
sing your
I
praises.
Love to sing your praises. Heaven to earth,
you came from heaven to earth to show.
Just think about the fact that he came down just to show you what to do, to show you where to go, to cover your life. God did that to cover you. He did that for your debts, for your sins. Oh, yes, you did. God, I lift your name on high. Oh, yes, I lift your name on high. God, you're worthy. Just think about something that he did for you on yesterday. Just think about something that he did for you just on this morning. And just for that reason, we all say, lift up his name on high. Let's try this one more time. Lord, I lift your name on high.
Lord, I lift your name on high.
Just to see. where you are. Hallelujah. Come on, let's just begin to worship God.
Oh Lord.
Hallelujah.
Oh, yes.
Say, God, I want to be where you are.
I gotta be where you are.
I want to be where you are.
I want to be where you are.
I gotta be where you are.
I gotta be where you are.
Come on, let's just sing for your glory all together. For your glory.
For your glory.
Just think about what we're singing. For your glory, I will do anything. I'll do whatever it takes just to get in your presence, oh God. Because in your presence is the fullness of God. It's the fullness of joy. In your presence there is healing.
To behold you as my King.
For your glory.
For your glory.
I will do anything, oh God.
I will do
whatever it takes of myself. God, I will press in your presence, Lord. Yes, just to see you, Lord. To be in your presence, Lord.
Yeah, yeah.
I want to be where you are.
I want to be where
God, you are. I want to be where you are.
I
got to
be where you are.
Say, God, I'll do whatever it takes.
I will do.
God, I'll sacrifice myself for you. I'll be selfless in this season. I'll press past the way I'm feeling on today just to be where you are.
To behold you as my King.
For your glory.
For your glory.
Just begin to wave your hand and you say, God, for your glory.
I will do.
I want to be where he is.
I gotta be where you are.
I want to be where you are. I've got to be where you are.
I want to be
where you are. gotta be where.
Yeah, I'm laying at your feet. I wanna be.
I wanna be where.
God, I gotta be. God, I wanna be where you
gotta
are.
Gotta be where you are.
For your glory, I will do anything just to see.
Come on and put your hands together. If you say, God, I want to be where you are. If I want to dwell in your presence. Is there anybody here that says, I don't need to be pumped up into praise. I don't need to be washed into worship. God has been just that good to me. But when I come into his presence, I will open up my mouth and worship him. He healed my body. He delivered my son. He brought my daughter closer to him. So because of those things, I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praises shall continuously be upon my lips. Oh, taste and see just how good God has been to me. Come on, just for a few minutes, let's begin to worship God. All you got to do is just think about how he woke you up today and how your neighbor is sleeping in their grave. All you got to do is think about how you could have been in a hospital. All you got to do is think about what he's done for you, and you should begin to worship him. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Unchanging hand. Trust.
changing hand. When your journey is completed, if to God you have been true, oh, forever I the hope. God's unchanging hand. Oh, hold on. Hold on to his hand. Oh, build your hopes on me. Oh, hold to God's unchanging hand. Come on, y'all need to stand up on your feet. Come on and stand up if you know that this means war.
Yeah. All right. Yeah. All right.
I got joy in my soul. God is in control. I got Satan on my trail, but I'm singing all is well. He's attacking every day, but I'm watching while I pray. No matter the attack, I won't turn back.
War.
Oh, this means war.
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 Yeah. I've got joy in my soul. Yeah. God is in control. Yeah. I got Satan on my trail. Yeah. But I'm singing all is well. He's attacking every day.
I plead the blood.
There's power in the blood.
I plead the blood.
There's healing in the blood.
I plead the blood.
I've been through the storm and rain, yeah. But the blood remains the same. Whatever's going wrong, I got my war clothes. Might be in a day, but I'm watching while I pray.
This means war.
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 I plead the blood.
I plead the blood.
I plead the blood. You can't have my family.
Hey.
You can't have my increase.
All right.
Hey.
You can't have my breakthrough. You can't have my.
I plead the blood. I plead the blood.
Oh, you can't have my family.
Yeah. All right.
Oh, you can't have my increase.
Yeah.
You can't have my breakthrough.
Yeah.
Oh, you can't have my. You can't have my. I plead the blood.
I plead the blood. I plead the blood.
There's healing in the blood.
I plead the blood.
Deliverance in the blood.
I plead the blood.
Oh, I plead the blood.
I plead the blood.
I plead the blood. One more time.
I plead the blood.
Church, say amen. And the redeemed of the Lord say hallelujah. If we have any guests with us today, any persons that are our guests today here at the church, if you would stand at this time to let us know that you are a guest so we might properly greet you. Amen. Praise be the name of the Lord. Amen. 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 Do we have any others? And if you would just remain standing for a moment. We're not going to ask you all those questions they ask you at church, like where you're from and your name and all that. We'd love to know those things, but we really would love more to let you know how excited we are to have you here with us today. So all across the sanctuary, as we greet our brothers and sisters, make sure we greet our guests and let them know it's an honor to have you in the house of the Lord with us today. You passed by a whole lot of churches to get here. We praise the name of the Lord that God sent you here with us today. So come on and stand, greet Your brothers and sisters, greet our guests and let them know it's glad to be in the house of the Lord one more time. Hello. Blessing to be in the house of the Lord one more time. We have our announcements. Right after our announcements, we're going to have a very brief video that our sound ministry is going to have ready for us. A brief video right after our announcements. We're going to try something new and see if it works. Amen. And see what the Lord shall bring. Praise the Lord. Amen. It will work. I'm sure it'll work. It'll be fine. All right. Praise the Lord. Now, amen. Praise the Lord. A couple of announcements today. And if you hear these announcements from me and then you may hear them again read later on, please forgive me. But you know, sometimes we have to hear things two and three times before it sinks in. Amen. Praise be the name of the Lord. So a couple of announcements. First of all, would like to please, as Bishop, our Bishop White would say, pretty, pretty please, pretty please, pretty please. This afternoon, I'm preaching at Second Baptist in Ypsilanti, our sister church, located at 301 South Hamilton Street in Ypsilanti, as they celebrate Pastor Waddle's third pastoral anniversary and appreciation. Really excited about going over to be with Second Baptist in Ypsi. Pastor Waddles is a good friend of mine. We've done a lot of work together and continuing to do a lot of work together with the Ministerial Alliance, and just a great man of God, great friend of mine. So looking forward to everyone coming out to be with us today at 3:30. They are serving food. Dinner will be served until 3 o'clock. So you can leave here. If you get there around 2, I'm sure you'll be able to eat. Dinner served until 3. And I believe Mass Choir is going to be there with us. Come on, let's give God some praise. The Mass Choir will be there with us today. And so we're going to have a great time praising, celebrating the name of the Lord, and thanking God for the great pastor, Pastor Waddles. That's at 3:30, Second Baptist in Ypsi this afternoon. Looking forward to everyone for coming out to be with us. Also, we have our third quarterly conference coming up. There's no meeting, but reports still need to be submitted. Please submit your reports by Tuesday of April 4th for the months of December through February. December of last year through February of this year, reports are due in the office by Tuesday to Sister Harrison, that we might compile the reports and send them to the elder. Also, we're cleaning the palms. It's that time again. It's Palm Sunday coming up. Volunteers are needed on this Saturday at 10:30 to help prepare the palms for Palm Sunday. You can see any one of our stewardesses, and they will help you in that process to volunteer. We need all the help we can get. They have a lot of fun, believe it or not, cleaning the palms. It's a good opportunity to come out and to fellowship. Maybe not a lot of fun, but some fun. Amen. Cleaning the palms. And I thank them for all that they do, and thank those who are volunteering as well. So please come on out if you're able to help. Women of Bethel are having a meeting Thursday at 6 p.m., sharing ideas about some things they want to do, events, travels, activities, anything they'd like to do as a group. That's Thursday at 6 p.m. Looking forward to everyone coming out. Holy Week is coming up, and in our Holy Week activities, we have our Palm Sunday service next week at 10 a.m. Then on the Wednesday of Holy Week, we're having a community health care forum hosted by the Ministerial Alliance, sponsored by also State Representative Ronnie Peterson, Congresswoman Debbie Dingell, the County Commission, particularly Ricky Jefferson, and we have a representative also from Packard Clinic. We're going to have a, I don't want to call it a town hall, because when you say town hall, you know, sometimes people get a little riled up. So it's that, it's a panel. It's more of a panel discussion. It's going to be Thursday at 6, Wednesday, the Wednesday of Holy Week, Wednesday, April 12th at 6 p.m., we're looking forward to everyone coming out to be with us. It's at Ypsilanti High School. I think it's Ypsilanti Community High School now is the official name, but formerly Ypsilanti High School. It's going to be that evening, Wednesday, April 12th at 7 p.m. It's going to go from 7 to 8:30. Please come on out. We're going to talk about how the potential appeal and changes to the Affordable Health Care Act will affect us. As you see, it's in flux now. A lot of stuff is going on. Where better to get the information than from the top? We will have one who is in the room making the decisions, and our Congresswoman, Debbie Dingell, to speak with us about it, and we'll know more about what's going on. So please come on out. That's during Holy Week. That's Wednesday, April 12th. Then we have Good Friday service on the 14th at 12 p.m., Second Baptist in Ypsi again, the same church we're going to this afternoon. That's Good Friday, Friday, April 14th at 12 p.m., where we will have the seven last words. I will be preaching the first word this year, so get there early if you would like to hear your pastor. I will get there. I will be the first word. Now, if you come to the seven last words, try to stay the whole time. Don't just hear your pastor preach and your choir sing, and then it's a mass exodus to get up and walk out like nobody else has anything to say. Amen. I know y'all don't do that, but for the two or three that may, amen, please try to stay if you can stay. That's going to be on Good Friday, 12 o'clock p.m. And then on Sunday, April 16th, I'm so excited, on Easter Sunday, we will have one service at 10 a.m. We're going to pack the place out, one service. If we run out of room in here, we'll have overflow set up. We'll have our parking lot attendance. Our parking lot ministry will be in place. Everything will be fine. Don't you worry. You're going to have a great time. And if you're worried about it being crowded, then get here early. Amen. You get here early, you don't have to worry about it being crowded. Praise the Lord. Amen. So that's going to be on Easter Sunday, and Bishop Philip R. Cousin, my father, our former bishop, the 96th elected consecrated bishop, former senior bishop of the African Methodist Episcopal Church, is preaching on that Sunday morning. I'm so excited to have my dad out preaching for us, and he's going to have a great time. We're going to have a great time. So please come on out and be with us on that day as we celebrate our risen Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Also would like to let everyone from Bible study know, Bible study will be taking place during Holy Week as well on that Tuesday, just as it's taking place this Tuesday at noon and 7 p.m. This Tuesday Bible study, we're going to do the story of Jonah. We're doing Jonah and the whale. It's going to be probably, if you can read all, I think it's four chapters in the book of Jonah. If you read all four, that's great, but I think we're focusing primarily on one and two. One and two this week, Book of Jonah. We talk about Jonah and the belly of the whale for a Bible study. Look forward to everyone coming out. Thanking everyone for coming out. And our final announcement today, people are able to sign their kids up for the lock-in with Sister Cara right after service in the multipurpose room. The lock-in is Friday, April 28th at 7 p.m. and Saturday, April 29th at 8 a.m. for kids 6 through 12. Dinner and a light breakfast will be served. Where's Cara? Cara is able to sign people up. Both children and volunteers can sign up with Cara today, and we look forward to it all. Amen? Amen. These are our announcements. Please, let's govern ourselves accordingly. Now we're going to turn things over to our sound ministry, who's going to show us a brief video. Amen. If our ushers would come forward as we prepare ourselves for our offering this day, we're pulling out all the stops, using whatever medium, whatever media, whatever formats we can, in any way we can, personal testimonies, videos, instructions, anything to let persons know the seriousness, the gravity, the severity of our relationship with God. And when we give to God and as we tithe to God, as the video stated, it's not about the church needing the money, or it's not about trying to be scammed, or not about anything like that. It's really about a deeper relationship with God. We would like to be able to say we do everything or try to do everything God asks us to do. And one of the primary things God asks us to do is give to him that which belongs to God. Give to God that which belongs to God. So in the middle, we have our tithing box. The 10% that we give unto God coming from the 100% God gives unto us. Next to the tithing box, we have ushers holding baskets for offerings over and above or other than the tithe. For those that say, Reverend, I'm not tithing yet, or I have a special ministry I'd like to give to, maybe you'd like to give towards the mortgage. We praise the Lord. I think our mortgage is down almost $25,000. Come on, let's give God some praise. Almost $25,000 we're down, and we're still moving forward, and we look forward to continuing to pay down our mortgage. I think the amount now, we started out about right about 145, and now I think we're right at about 121. So I think we're almost at 25,000. So we praise and celebrate the name of the Lord. We could not have done it without you. We can't continue to do it without you. We pay off the mortgage. It opens us up to do some more things, and we celebrate and praise the Lord for the doors that God is opening. And on the end, we have our ushers who hold baskets for our AIM offering. The AIM offering is an offering that's used for acquisition, improvement, and maintenance, that we might acquire, improve, and maintain that which God has given us, similar to what you would call a rainy day fund. If things happen, if things pop up, we will be able to address them quickly and easily. It's been a blessing thus far in not just helping us pay off the property, but when we've had things occur at church that we needed fixed immediately, we were able to draw from the AIM fund to pay for that, and we praise the Lord for that as well. That we're asking persons to give $5 per week per person towards the AIM offering. All of this can be done electronically. All of this can be done in the Bethel store. It can be done from right where you are, from your laptop, from your iPad, from your phone, or whatever the case may be. All of this can be done from there. And one of the things I've really found that's a blessing, and I want to give you the proper telephone number, it's really been a blessing, is the text to tithe. Text to tithe has been a blessing for me, because that is how I give my tithe each and every week. You set it up one time, and all you have to do is, once you set it up, you just put in an amount, press the button, and your tithe is done. And the number for text to tithe is 734-224-2707. 734-224-2707. It's a blessing. But however you choose to do, please give to God that which belongs to God. As you've seen from the story, and as we've seen from so many testimonies, you can't go wrong by giving to God. All it does is bring you closer, draw you closer, and trust me, it will be a blessing unto you. Shout out to our online viewers, and thank you so much to our online, those that sow seeds in this ministry. We praise and celebrate the name of the Lord with and for you. Let us bow our heads for a moment of prayer. Gracious and everlasting God, we thank you for this opportunity once again to give unto you, and we ask that as we give these gifts, you would bless them, multiply them, and distribute them as we draw closer to you, praying for a deeper relationship with you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our ushers will now direct us in our giving. I'm heading over to the Bethel store if anyone wants to head on over and give that way. We thank you, thank you, thank you so much for all that you do.
We
some songs lest it becomes a new song to me, because just a week ago I was in the hospital for 7 days and for 6 nights. So when I think about the goodness of Jesus and all he's done for me, and I begin to sing blessed, I'm blessed because I'm a living testimony. I'm a breathing testimony. I'm a walking testimony. And not just that I'm blessed, God has allowed us to live in the overflow. Is there anybody that says, I don't want to just live in the regular, I want to live in the overflow? Sometimes you got to speak it before you see it. I'm living in the overflow. 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 Come on, sing with me.
I'm living in the overflow. I'm living in the overflow.
Yeah.
I'm living in the overflow. I'm living in the overflow.
I'm trying to make it personal.
I'm living in the overflow. I'm living in the overflow.
I'm living in the overflow.
I'm living in the overflow.
Night hour.
Let's give God some praise for our praise team. And we praise the Lord also for our director today, Reverend Danielle Pinson. Come on, let's give God some praise for Reverend Danielle. Amen. And of course, for our music ministry under the direction of Brother Leonard Alford. Come on, let's give God some praise for music ministry under the direction of Brother Alford as we praise and celebrate the name of the Lord together. For the purposes of today's sermon, if we could just go back to the scripture that was read earlier for us, and I'll read it briefly. John, the 11th chapter, verses 1 through 6, 17 through 23, and 41 through 44. Once again, that's John 11, 1 through 6, 17 through 23, 41 through 44, reading as follows. A man named Lazarus was sick. He lived in Bethany with his sisters, Mary and Martha. This is the Mary who later poured the expensive perfume on the Lord's feet and wiped them with her hair. Her brother Lazarus, he was sick. So the two sisters sent a message to Jesus telling him, Lord, your dear friend is very sick. But when Jesus heard about it, he said, Lazarus' sickness will not end in death. No, it happened for the glory of God. So the Son of God will receive glory from this. So although Jesus loved Martha, Mary, and Lazarus, he stayed where he was for the next 2 days. When Jesus arrived at Bethany, he was told that Lazarus had already been in the grave for 4 days. Bethany was only a few miles down the road from Jerusalem, and many of the people had come to console Martha and Mary in their loss. When Martha got word that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed in the house. Martha said to Jesus, Lord, if only you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that God will give you whatever you ask. Jesus told her, your brother will rise again. So they rolled the stone aside. Jesus looked up to heaven and said, Father, thank you for hearing me. You always hear me, but I said it out loud for the sake of all these people standing here so that they will believe you sent me. Then Jesus shouted, Lazarus, come out. And the dead man came out, his hands and feet bound in grave clothes, face wrapped in a headcloth. And Jesus told them, unwrap him and let him go. For just a few moments today, as we celebrate the goodness of God, I ask that we would consider this subject. Your request is being processed. Your request is being processed. We gather today in the midst of the Lenten season, and we are moving closer and closer to Easter. Next week is Palm Sunday. Time is flying by so fast. And each year, beginning with what we call Ash Wednesday and ending with Easter Sunday, we acknowledge the season of Lent, paying special attention to the life and ministry of Jesus. During this season, we've embarked upon a sermon series I like to call Our Journey with Jesus. We began the journey with Matthew's temptation account as we studied God's plan for preparation. We learned that God prepares us through his guidance, through his word, and finally through his presence. Then we continued with our journey as we learned how Jesus comes to save us. We looked at the third chapter of John and the story of Nicodemus, learning that Jesus saves us no matter where we are, no matter who we are, and finally, even when we don't realize we need to be saved. Next, we continued with our journey as we learn how Jesus brings about a change in us. We looked at his encounter with the woman at the well, and we learned how Jesus changes our perspective, our perception, and even changes our purpose. And today, as we move forward in our journey with Jesus, we begin to understand how Jesus handles our requests. Raise your hand if you're here today and you can remember recently asking God for something. Anybody? All right. So everybody in here. And if you didn't raise your hand, then you ain't got what you ain't got because you ain't asked. Amen. But everybody else, everybody who did raise their hand, amen. We're honest. We know that we did ask God to do something in our lives. And all of us probably ask God numerous times in a day to do something in our lives. And then as we ask God to do it, we really expect for it to be done when we want it to be done. And I believe that God is not a God of if. I don't believe God is a conditional God. I believe that God is not a God of if, but God is a God of when. So whatever we ask God for, it's never a matter of if God will do it, but if it is in God's will, it's just about when God is going to do it. And when we make a request to God, we got to believe that God's going to answer the request. But the problem is we have to deal with the processing time. So in the scripture, we find Jesus learning about the sickness of his friend Lazarus, the brother of Mary and Martha. Jesus doesn't like to see anyone in pain, and I'm positive that when he saw his friend, not just in pain, but heard his friend was dead, Jesus was saddened. But Jesus says the sickness of Lazarus won't end in his death, but the sickness will be used to glorify God. If I had more time this morning, but I'm trying to get y'all to a point where we can go on and have our communion and go rest a little bit and go to our afternoon service. But I got to say this, if I have more time, I would like to delve into the fact sometimes what we go through ain't about us. Sometimes what we go through is only so that God can take us through whatever we're going through to bless somebody else and to give God the glory. So when you're going through something, don't always think of yourself like, woe is me, woe is me. Sometimes what we go through is so that somebody else can be blessed and God can receive the glory. So when Jesus hears about Lazarus's death, he remains where he was for two more days. Jesus knew that Lazarus was already dead. And when questioned, he told his disciples Lazarus would be raised so they would believe. And after 2 days, Jesus arrives in Judea to find that Lazarus was not only dead, but had been in the tomb for 4 days. When he arrived, Martha ran out and said, "If you had been here, my brother would still be alive." Jesus replies that I am the resurrection and the life. If you believe in me, you won't die, but you'll live forever. Jesus says your brother will not die. Then he proceeds to find Lazarus in the tomb. And after the stone is rolled away, Jesus says, "Come out, Lazarus." And the Bible said he comes forth from the grave, unwrapped, grave clothes off. And the Bible said, once again, Jesus performs another miracle. There are times in our lives, maybe even right now, where we're asking God to do stuff for us. And we will be forced to be patient while God processes the request that we have made. And as we journey with Jesus today, I want to help somebody and hopefully bless somebody today with this. Even if you can't see it, when you ask God for something, God is not deaf to your request. It's only that your request is being processed. Few things the Bible teaches us in this word today, and I promise I'll let you go. But the first is simply this. We have to make our request known to God. We have to make our request known. God has to know about our requests. Bible says you have not. Why? Because you ask not. Whenever we need to God to bless us, all we have to do is ask God to bless us. And when we make our request known to God, God always answers. Matter of fact, one of my favorite scriptures in the Bible is Jeremiah 33:3 that simply states, "Call unto me and I will answer you and I will show you great and mighty things that you did not know." But there's one issue. When I make a request to God, I have no idea how long it will take for God to answer. Usually when we make requests, we like stuff to be like we like it to be. And the problem we all deal with is there are times when we just not going to get something from God right away. And one of the most difficult things to deal with is waiting on God after we've asked God to do something for us. We live in a society where nobody wants to wait. It's funny having children, because sometimes I think God blessed me with children just so I don't have to get stuff for myself anymore that I used to have to get. I'll call my child down from upstairs and say, "Come on down here and hand me that remote control." And the remote control is maybe on the other side of the room. And the child better come down. Come on, y'all know. Y'all wasn't raised like me then. But, you know, the child better come and grab. Yesterday, Miriam was supposed to clean the kitchen. I said, "Miriam, clean the kitchen." And Miriam says, "I don't want to clean the kitchen right now." I said, "Baby, this life ain't about what you want. Amen. You're going to clean that kitchen right now so we can keep it moving." I asked her to do it. I wanted her to do it. She was supposed to do it right then. She didn't do it. Lost her iPad. That was that. Now, nobody, don't ask her about it, she's touchy. Now, no one wants to wait anymore. We want our food to be fast. Let one of us go in a restaurant and have somebody get served before we get served. Come on, y'all. or go to the place and order pizza and have it get there 32 minutes instead of 30 minutes, it's gonna be a problem. We want our news. It used to be a time the news was an hour long, then it was a half hour long. Now we got headline news. Now we got text alerts. Now we got watch alerts. Everything is getting shorter and shorter. We want our meals microwaved. The problem with a microwave meal is, though, sometimes it's hot on the outside but cold on the inside. Y'all will get that when you get home. And we even want instant coffee. We got the Keurigs now, where it comes out so fast and so clean because we're so busy. We want stuff to be taken care of as soon as we ask for it, but God doesn't work like that. Nobody wants to wait on anything, but I hate to tell you, you might not like waiting on stuff, but you're going to have to learn sometimes. When we make a request to God, it's not going to be answered immediately. So in the scripture, Jesus is informed of his friend Lazarus's sickness. His sisters make a request. And they say, Jesus, you need to come see about your friend. Notice they didn't even really ask Jesus to come and heal. They just said, Jesus, your friend is sick, which meant, please come and heal him. When Jesus is informed of his friend's sickness, Jesus being Jesus played it cool because everybody assumed, the disciples and the sisters, that Jesus was going to drop whatever he was doing and go take care of his boy. But Jesus learns about Lazarus's sickness and pending death. And instead of going to see about him, right then and there, Jesus says, no, I'm going to chill 2 days where I am. I think it was about, Reverend Dennis, 4 miles of a journey that Jesus had to travel from where he was to Bethany. So they figured Jesus would go knock that out. They walked everywhere. They figured Jesus would knock that out, walk, take care of it, and come back. And everybody was confused, the disciples and the sisters, because Jesus didn't move. He stayed where he was. And Jesus said to them, y'all got to understand, whenever I choose to go and take care of Lazarus, he's going to be all right. Jesus told them not to worry about when God was going to move. Just know that God would move. And when God moved, everything would be the way God wanted it to be. The request was made, it was heard, and God would answer whenever God was ready to answer. Well, I'm here to tell you today, the same is true for all of us. There are times in our lives where we call on God and expect God to immediately answer our request. But I hate to disappoint you, but everything that's an emergency to you is not an emergency to God. If I can say that one more time to really get in somebody's space today. If something is an emergency to you, that's an emergency for you. Does not necessarily mean that your request is at the top of God's to-do list for that day. Just because we make the request, that does not mean that God would immediately respond to it. And like the disciples learned, sometimes in life we can't worry about when God will move. We just have to praise God because we know he's going to move. That's where I am in my life now. I'm not so worried about when God's going to do it. I put the request out there. I know God's going to take care of it. And I don't try to tell God where and when to move in my life. I just praise God that God's going to move in my situation whenever God feels it and deems it necessary. I can't tell God what to do. I've learned to sit back and just let God be God. Is there anybody in here that finds joy in knowing I cannot control God or tell God where to go? But every time I've needed God, even if God did not respond when I wanted God to respond, God always stepped in at the perfect time to make sure my situation will be all right. And God knows exactly when to pull you out. God knows exactly when to come in. And when God does it, God says, you won't be hurt and my name will be exalted. Don't you worry about when God's going to come. Just know he'll come on time. Your request, when you make it, even if you don't get it answered immediately, don't worry. It's being processed. So as we make our request known to God, second thing we have to do, we have to learn how to wait. Now that we know we've made the request, here comes the waiting time. Once again, we hate to wait. If you don't believe me, just go stand in the Secretary of State's office one day. See how angry people get. Because they just have not learned how to wait. And some of us really don't know how to wait when it comes to waiting on the Lord. Because sometimes in our waiting on the Lord, we allow our minds to wander. And we become impatient, trying to figure out when God is going to do it. Then sometimes we get in our own way. Because we do get to a point where we try to tell God what God needs to do and how God needs to do it. And we try to orchestrate the moves and the maneuvers of God without realizing sometimes we just have to fall back and learn how to wait. Then we begin to worry about whether or not God has heard us, whether or not God will answer us, whether or not God is listening to us. And instead of worrying, we just must wait patiently on the Lord, for we know God has heard us. God is going to answer us when God is ready. We just have to learn how to wait. So Mary and Martha, they know how much Jesus loves them, and they know how much Jesus loves their brother. So they probably figured they were on the VIP list. They probably figured that they were at the top. And they probably figured that as soon as Jesus heard Lazarus was sick, he was going to drop whatever he was doing and go to where they were. So Jesus waits those 2 days. Imagine what the sisters were thinking, especially Martha, as they were waiting for Jesus to come. Imagine some of the stuff, not that Martha, the Martha in the Bible, amen. Imagine some of the stuff that would be going through your head while you were waiting on Jesus. I can imagine one of them saying, I can't believe he did this to us. I can imagine somebody saying, who does he think he is? He ain't the Messiah yet. He promised us he was going to save us. Ain't nobody saved yet. Who does he think he is? I thought he loved us. He told us that Lazarus was his boy. He told us he would walk across hot coals for Lazarus. He told us Lazarus was the one. Why in the world is he making us wait as our brother dies? I know he's out there healing and teaching and doing this and sick and salvation, but he ain't too busy that he can come see about me. I know this because I've had members say that to me before. Y'all got real quiet. Amen. I know you're busy, Reverend, but you ain't so busy that you can't stop what you're doing to come see about me. I'm the one you need to come see about. I need to preach to the preachers because y'all ain't listening. But Reverend, why ain't you come see about me? I'm the one that's important. I'm the one that's the leader of this ministry and the head of that. You need to come see about me. Why did you wait? I don't care if your child is sick, your wife is sick, your family's in disarray. Drop that and come see me. That's just how they felt. Amen. You out there healing these so-called sick folk you don't know, but you got a friend who's sick right here, and you mean to tell me you're going to sit on your tail and stay where you are and mock us for 2 days? Who does Jesus think he is? And then when Jesus does arrive, we know they were upset because one of the sisters ran out and said to him, the first thing she said was not, hello, my Lord, was not, glad you came by Jesus. It wasn't a hug. It wasn't to give him a plate of cookies and some milk. First thing she did was say, if you had been here, my brother would still be alive. Who do you think you are? Who do you think you're messing with? I just ain't some ordinary run-of-the-mill sister. I'm somebody who believes in you and who loves you, and I don't care what you're going to do tomorrow. You should have been here today. As Martha was waiting, her mind could not help but think about how Jesus should have been there for her above everybody else. And she could not have helped but imagine what would have happened if Jesus would have just gotten there a little bit earlier. But when she does find Jesus, she began to understand that everything that was done for the glory of God. Now, church, there's something we can learn from this. While we're waiting on the Lord, we got to be patient enough to understand God is going to come through. Everything is going to be all right. But God's got to do it when God wants to do it. So we got to be patient when we wait on God. Keep your minds from straying. While you're waiting on God, stay away from negative people. While you're waiting on God, stay away from folk that don't want to see you get blessed anyhow. While you're waiting on God, stay away from impatient spirits. And understand that if I keep my mind on Jesus, he's always going to make everything work out all right. And we need to believe that God is going to rescue us. God is going to deliver us. God is going to speak to us. But God's got to do it when God's ready to do it. Imagine how many times we wanted God to bless us, and God didn't bless us when we wanted to be blessed. But when God blessed us, the blessing was a whole lot better than the one we asked for when we originally, come on somebody, asked God for it. So we must understand, church, as we wait on the Lord, wait with patience, wait with the right mind. And as you wait, don't wonder. Know in your heart that God is processing your request. So we must ask God for it. We must learn to wait. And finally, in our minds, believe God is going to do it. The saddest thing about most Christians, and this is me too, I'm in here with y'all. We pray for God to do stuff for us. that we don't even believe God is going to do. Am I the only one in here that's bold enough to admit today, I've prayed for God to do something for me, and then the moment I got up off my knees, I said, he ain't going to do it. That's human nature. It's not denying who God is. It's just denying the worthiness of us and God listening to us. And our ability to say, I don't know if God's going to do it, that's not an indictment against God. Instead, that is just doubt against who we are. That's why I'm glad God does not process my request based upon how good I've been. I'm glad God does not process my request based upon how faithful I've been. I'm glad God does not process my request based upon what I've done for God. Because if God did those things, I'd hardly ever get it. But God doesn't worry about all that. God says, if you just trust me even a little bit, I'll make sure that everything you waited for, everything you asked for, everything you worked for, everything you talked to me about, I'm going to give it to you when the time is right. But it just takes some time. So in the scripture, Jesus gets to the tomb. He rolls the stone aside. He calls out Lazarus. Lazarus comes out alive. Mary and Martha made the request. And when they thought Jesus was not listening, all the while he was processing their request. And after the request was processed, some valuable lessons had to be learned. First lesson is this. You got to understand, when you wait on the Lord, you realize he is the resurrection and he is the life. So if I could unpack that for a minute, that means because he's the resurrection and because he's the life, there's not a thing in your life that's dead that he can't bring back. There's not a thing in your life that's destroyed that God cannot put back together again. That's why God can put back together families. God can put back together marriages. God can put back together finances. God can put back together our health. When we realize he is the resurrection and the life, there's nothing in our lives that is so far gone that God can't bring it back. We just got to believe it. As they waited on the Lord, they realized not even death can stop Jesus. Who is this man that the wind and the waves obey him? Who is this man that is able to call upon a mountain and the mountain shall move? Who is this man that is able to call forth those that have been dead and stinking and smelling in the tomb? But all he has to do is wave his hand and say a word and they get up and rise up and come out. Nothing God can't do. As they waited on the Lord, when they saw their brother rise up and shake off the grave clothes, they couldn't help but think about how they were wrong to Jesus. Couldn't help but think about how many times they doubted him. Couldn't help but think about how they let the sideline people come in and tell them what Jesus couldn't do. But the moment they saw Lazarus get up out that tomb and shake off those grave clothes, they began to understand, can't nobody do it like my Jesus. I wish I had about four people in here today that understood right now, God is shaking some stuff loose in your life. Right now, God is taking the grave clothes off of some dead stuff in your life. Right now, God is calling forth things that you've given up on, calling forth things that you thought were destroyed, calling forth things that you were done with. And God is saying, get up and rise up. Let that job rise up. Let that relationship rise up. Let those finances rise up. Let that healing rise up. Let your spirit rise up. Shake off the grave clothes. Come on out. God said it's not about whether or not I'm going to do it. I just haven't done it yet. And don't you worry, your request is being processed. You've made it known to God. God's making a way out of no way. And when you get ready and God gets ready and everything is ready, God's going to process your request and everything's going to come back to life. Come on and stand up. There are benefits to delayed blessings. So many of us have been, we feel, denied. God given us some things we've asked for. But there are benefits to delayed blessings. Imagine, y'all, for those that can imagine this, what life would be like for you if God would have given you everything you asked for when you asked for it. Think of how miserable your marriage would be right now if God had let you marry the one you thought you were supposed to marry. Instead of the one God had designed for you to marry. I wish I had some help in here today. Y'all must all marry the right folk, I'm sorry. Or the wrong ones for that matter. Imagine if God would have given you that job you prayed so earnestly for, only to realize that because you didn't get that one, the experience made you ready for the next one that came along that was far better than the one you thought you could get. It's never about if God is going to do it. God will do it for you, whatever it is. But we've got to realize that God is processing our requests. Don't be afraid to make your requests known to God. Don't ever be afraid to ask God for anything. Even stuff that seems silly to you, ask God for it. And if it is in God's will, and if it is for the betterment of God's people, and if it's the blessing not just to you but for somebody else, it's got to be some things in there. But if it's in there, God's going to do it, I guarantee it. And when God does it, it's going to be a blessing, but you got to wait. Might not happen today. Everything does not happen overnight. God doesn't operate. And the problem many of us have is we bosses on our jobs. So it's like the man that came to Jesus. What did he tell Jesus? When I tell people to move, they move. And I know I can't do that with you, Lord, but when I tell people to move, they move. And y'all know some of y'all are bosses. Now, come on now. Y'all walk up in the office every day like George Jefferson. Walking, you know, you're going to get that over there, do that over there for me, and you're going to do this. Do it. Lois says that's how I am. That's why she's over there smiling right now, laughing, but I ain't like that, y'all. But nevertheless, it doesn't work like that with God. You can't just tell God to do something and expect it to be done right away. You got to wait. And as you wait on God, get stronger. You know what I found out that waiting on God does? And I promise I'm going to leave y'all alone, but I got to share this. Waiting on God allows me to be more faithful. Waiting on God allows me to be more committed and more trusting to God. And finally, waiting on God lets me know that when I do get what God's got for me, I'm going to appreciate it like I never would have appreciated it before. God's not going to give it to you right away just so you can dog it, just so you can throw it to the side and act like it was supposed to be yours. When God gives you that which God has just for you, that's tailor-made for you, that's cut just for you, that's just for you, and you get it, God's going to show you how wonderful it is that all the while you thought God wasn't listening, he was processing your request. Old saying goes, every goodbye ain't gone, and every shut eye ain't sleep. You might think God is gone. You might think God is not listening. You may think God's eyes have closed. But trust me, God's right there, refining, working it out, getting it together, so that when the time is right, whatever you ask God for, God's going to give you that and so much more. So right now, as this is our first Sunday, I don't want to miss the opportunity. If there's anyone under the sound of my voice who desires to join the church today to be a member of this household of faith, we'd love to have you here with us. We don't want to miss this opportunity, and we do want you to come down. And if you are one who wants to join church, as you come down, just let us know. We'll make sure and address your needs. If there's one who desires salvation, once again, when you come on down, let us know. We will address your needs. We do not want to miss this opportunity, even for those that desire prayer. But we do take this time today as being the first Sunday of the month to celebrate the Lord's Supper, celebrate Holy Communion. So at this time, if there are those that desire to join or desire a word of prayer or desire to be saved, I want you to come down too, but I want you just to hold off if you would. Just wait for a moment. Hold off for a moment and let us know, and we'll come to you, I promise, as soon as the Holy Communion is over. But those first table of supper, I desire that you will come on down right now. I desire to be the first table of the Lord's Supper. Come down right now. If you are one who desires to be the first table of the Lord's Supper, ministerial staff, y'all come on down.